Tukaram's teachings. Although the poems in part two of this book will show Tukaram's teachings in some detail, it may be useful to discuss them briefly here to give an overall view of his message. The teachings of Tukaram are no different from those of other saints of the highest order. He declares that he draws them from the same mine of truth which has been in existence since time began. These teachings have since gathered dust, and their true meaning has been obscured by the passage of time. So he has come to explain them anew. Because of his spiritual attainments, he is fully qualified to do this. He himself says that he is a resident of the Lord's abode who has come down for the benefit of the people of his time. The significance of human birth. Like all saints, Tukaram says that our soul is part of the Supreme Soul, the omnipresent Lord, and that there is no difference between the two. The oneness of the individual soul and the Supreme Soul is revealed in the following poem. Cream, curd, and butter all come from the same milk. Various ornaments are made from the same gold. Different pots are fashioned from the same clay. Just so, the Lord takes many forms, but in them all is the one soul. The soul, having trapped itself in Maya, collects good and bad karmas and continues to go round in the cycle of birth and death. It runs after the mirage of worldly happiness, never finding any lasting peace. Tukaram describes the plight of the soul in the following lines. The soul was, in truth, free, but it chose to be bound by getting entangled in me and mine. It tires itself out, running after a mirage, like a deer in pursuit of water. Like all saints, Tukaram says that only after many lives and with much good karma does one obtain a human life. This life should be used for devotion to the Lord, in order to attain liberation from the cycle of birth and death and to return to Him. He tells the Lord about Himself in one of His poems. After many years I got this fortune of your devotion. Now I'll sacrifice my life for it and burn away this worldly life. I worry that once this human life is over, I may not get another one. Tukaram, like other saints, talks about the human body as the temple of the living God, where the Lord is to be sought and realized. He declares that even the gods crave a human body so that they can merge with the Lord and have eternal happiness. A life of devotion to the Lord can only be lived in the human body. Tukaram is against procrastination in the matter of devotion. He exhorts, when you get a human birth, repeat the Lord's name and obtain happiness. Like a thief, the Lord of death is following you and counting your days. So hurry up, don't delay. The time of death is not in our hands. Outer display, external religious practices, rituals and ceremonies. Tukaram and other saints say that God can be realized only in the human form. The question then arises, how to find Him? Generally, people are ignorant of how to realize God. They are misled by charlatans or by ignorant priests or by their own traditional beliefs. They go to man-made places of worship to engage in rites and rituals. They go on pilgrimages or to mountains or forests in search of God. Tukaram asks them, what have you gained by pilgrimages to holy places? You have merely washed the exterior of your body. In what way has your mind been purified that such visits may be considered to be of any merit? So long as there is no peace, forgiveness, and mercy within, what are you bragging about? Asks Tuka. Tukaram explains that we find only water and stones in places of pilgrimage, whereas God is immanent in saints. To attain salvation, it is not necessary to go to Varanasi or to any such place. Footnote: Varanasi, Indian city and place of pilgrimage, formerly known as Banaras. Many Hindus believe that if they die in Varanasi, they will attain salvation. End footnote. It is enough to behold a saint. Countless sins are destroyed by the darshan of a saint. Tukaram denounces empty display, whether it be intellectual showing off, sitting in yoga postures, or subjecting oneself to penances and austerities. None of these leads to knowledge of the Lord. It is well known that early in his spiritual quest, Tukaram worshipped his family deity, Vitthal. Later, with his guru's benediction and practice of Naam, he realized the Lord within himself, and the name Vitthal became identified with the Supreme Being. Although Tukaram has dedicated a large number of poems to Vitthal, it should be understood that Vitthal, Pandurang, Keshav, Hari, Narayan, and Ram are simply some of the names he has given to the Supreme Lord. He describes the Lord as follows. O Lord, you are supreme bliss incarnate, free from attributes, invisible, inconceivable, infinite, and eternal. You willingly take on many names and forms depending on our level of devotion. Initiation by a true master. If outer search is useless, then what will lead us to God? Tukaram counsels that initiation by a true master, Satguru, is essential. At the time of initiation, the master gives the disciple the gift of Naam and imparts the correct technique of meditation. He connects the disciple's soul with the divine sound within and helps him on the inward journey, thus enabling the disciple to attain his goal. Tukaram says, "The Shabad is truly the essence of everything. It is the greatest gift which can be given. Knowledge of the ultimate can be obtained only through the Satguru." He therefore fervently prayed to the Lord to send him a master to guide him on the spiritual journey back home. When the Lord finally reveals himself, Tukaram humbly expresses his gratitude and indebtedness to his master. He says, "My master has blessed me, and now I live in the rhythm of the divine melody. By the grace of my Satguru, the light has been lit within me." Like other saints, Tukaram sees the master not just as someone who is one with the Lord, but as the Lord himself. He declares, "The Lord has met me in the form of my master." He therefore exhorts, "Lest this human birth be wasted, pray, serve at the feet of the Satguru." Qualifications and obligations of seekers. Spiritual seekers should be sincere and devoted. Their sole objective should be God realization. They should have full faith in the Master and his teachings. They should be prepared to surrender themselves completely and sacrifice everything for the love of the Master and the Lord. Tukaram says, "If you love your master with your whole heart, you have achieved everything. Otherwise, his company won't help you. Water and stone live together, yet the pebble remains dry within. As the moth loves the flame and burns itself in it, this is how to love the Lord." Seekers may be literate or illiterate, men or women, married or unmarried. They may be from any social background, but they should be honest and truthful. They should not be a burden on anybody. They may be householders. They need not be celibates or ascetics. Tukaram himself was not an ascetic. He was a trader and householder. Seekers should also be vegetarian and abstain from alcohol. They should not desire the wealth of others. They should not concern themselves with members of the opposite sex outside their own families. But all of this is not enough. Tukaram says, "It is only a person with past merits who is drawn to the company of the saints." A true master. Tukaram emphasizes the point that we cannot achieve liberation from the cycle of birth and death without a true master. Only such a master can help us to practice meditation, contact the Shabad, and thus attain liberation in this life itself. Tukaram cautions that utmost care should be taken by a seeker when accepting someone as his master, since true saints are rare in this world, but there are many frauds who pose as true saints. He says, if an exhausted man goes to another exhausted man, both of them will perish. He deplores those who pose as sadhus by donning ochre-colored robes, going about with matted hair and begging for alms from door to door. He condemns such a life, which makes one a parasite on society. He warns against such sham sadhus and speaks out in no uncertain terms against hypocrites and fakes. He observes, clothes do not make someone a saint. A poet is not necessarily a saint. Relatives of a saint are not saints. Reading scriptures, singing and making music, or going on pilgrimages does not make anyone a saint. As long as a saint does not forget his body, he is a man of the world. Then who is a true saint? Tukaram answers, a saint is one whose attachment is only to the Lord. His body, worldly wealth, and honor are as inconsequential to him as a blade of grass. He never misses meditation. He sees God everywhere. A saint's heart is like butter, soft, both inside and out. He holds close to his heart those with no other support. He is the very image of the Lord himself. Saints come into this world only for the benefit of human beings. For this, they endure bodily hardships. Kindness is their asset. Having no concern for themselves, saints are happy in the happiness of others, and nectar flows from their tongues. A true saint comes with the inexhaustible treasury of God's name and gives from it freely to those who sincerely pray for it. He teaches seekers the technique of meditation. When a seeker meets a saint, he immediately sees the saint's majesty and grandeur, and that is more fascinating than anything that he had heard about the saint from others. Tukaram says of himself, "The Lord has sent me to this world as bearer of his name. What do I know of deep philosophy? I am his slave. His stamp is on me." In a moment of ecstasy, he issues an open invitation. "I have opened the treasure trove of the Lord's name with the measure of plenty in my hand. Now there is a superabundance of the Lord's name where there was once a shortage. A time of plenty has come for the name. The famine is at an end. Come, both young and old, and enjoy these riches to your heart's content." The Lord's name or Naam. What is this name of the Lord which Tukaram and other saints talk about? The true name of the Lord has been referred to by Tukaram and other saints as the Word, Logos, Naam, Shabad, Sound, Kalma, Tao, Unstruck Music, Sound Current, creative power of God, and by many other terms. Tukaram says, "The Word is God. Let us honor and worship the Word." He further says, "The unstruck music reverberates in all beings." It is often thought that this name is just a written or spoken word or group of words, perhaps taken from scriptures or perhaps passed on orally from guru to disciple. But this is not completely correct. The name functions at two levels. At the human level, it does function as the names given at initiation by a true master. But the purpose of these names is to lead to concentration so the real name can be realized. This unutterable name functions at God's level as the divine melody, the word, the Shabad. It emanates from the Lord and is experienced through soul consciousness. While repetition of the names given at initiation by a true master can lead to the higher name, this higher name is quite unlike any of the names which we give to God. All such names are descriptive or attributive names. When Tukaram and other saints talk about the name, they are generally referring to its Shabad aspect, to the power that created, pervades, and sustains the entire creation. Only the true name has the highest spiritual energy. It alone can lead the soul back to the Lord. Tukaram says, "With the name, the wheel of births and deaths comes to an end. This is the only way to happiness. Put your trust in it. Partake of this nectar. If one is attached to the name of the Lord, the mesh of illusion is cut asunder and the ocean of existence evaporates." The power of the name is manifested in the form of sound and light. Tukaram refers to the sound and light of Naam in a number of his poems. The sound pulls the soul upward, and the light illuminates the path. Sound and light are two aspects of the same power, the word. Tukaram says of his experience, "Sitting at the Lord's feet, Tukaram is immersed in a surging wave of divine sound. The Lord has taken up residence in me, and the unquenchable flame shines there." In another verse, he talks about the potency of the name thus, "What could not be understood in any other way can be grasped by uttering the Lord's name. What was invisible before will become visible by uttering the name. What was unutterable before will find expression on repeating the name. And the one who could not be found before will himself come to meet you on repeating the name." He summarizes the importance of Naam in Kaliyug, the Iron Age, thus, "In Kaliyug, salvation is obtained only through the Lord's name." Meditation. A true master not only bestows the gift of Naam on sincere seekers, but also teaches them the technique of meditation. Meditation has three aspects or stages. First is Simran, repeating the names given by the master while concentrating one's attention at the midpoint between the eyebrows. Second is Dhyan, contemplating on the form of the master within. Third is Bhajan, listening to the inner sound. Correct meditation results in seeing the master's form within and hearing the divine sound. The sound pulls the soul upward, and the light associated with it shows the way to reach the realm of God. The master's form guides the devotee on the spiritual journey. It is difficult to endure the rigors of meditation unless one is truly courageous, dedicated to the cause, and determined to achieve his objective. Tukaram says, "You will not be called valiant if you are not able to face the rigors of meditation. A diamond will shine in all its brilliance only after it endures the strokes of a hammer." He also says that anything can be achieved with practice, effort and determination. A root manages to find a way through hard rocks. A rope can cut big stones. One can digest poison by consuming it in small doses. Likewise, God can be reached by regularity in meditation. We need to have faith. Tukaram says, when you depend on Him, the Lord will not disappoint you. But your efforts must match the efforts which you make for procuring earthly gains. Simran. As long as one's attention is spread out in the world through the 9 outlets of the body, one cannot hear the divine sound and see the unquenchable flame within. When a devotee withdraws his attention from the 9 outlets, concentrates it between the 2 eyebrows and repeats the Lord's name as instructed by his master, then his inner eye will open and he will experience sound and light. In Tukaram's words, the sun rises in the midst of darkness. Pierce through your 3rd eye and see the brightness. Unless you concentrate at the 3rd eye, you will not see the bright sun within, nor will you know yourself. This is the only way to obtain God realization. Remembering the Lord by ceaseless simran is the supreme prayer. Tukaram says, one who repeats the Lord's name with every morsel gets the merit of fasting even though he eats. One who repeats the Lord's name while doing daily work always has the bliss of meditation within him. One who repeats the Lord's name while walking gets the merit of yajna, sacrifice, at every step. Blessed is such a body. It has no need of pilgrimages and vows. One who repeats the Lord's name both in enjoyment and sacrifice of worldly pleasures is not bound by his actions. One who thus repeats the Lord's name ceaselessly is liberated during this very lifetime. Simran will enable the disciple to withdraw his consciousness to the eye center, listen to the sound and see the light within, follow the inner spiritual path, and come in contact with the Lord, the very aim of meditation. Ultimately, Tukaram says, by repetition, man becomes God. Dhyan and Darshan. As mentioned earlier, contemplation on the form of the Master is known as Dhyan. If a devotee contemplates on the form of his Master, then ultimately, the Master's inner true form will appear within to guide him in his spiritual journey. This is Darshan of the Master within. Without the Master's help within, it is impossible to realize God or even make any progress in the journey. Tukaram says, inner contemplation is the real worship. Know this to be the secret, if you wish to know. My happiness knows no bounds when I see the Master's form within. An intense longing for you forever resides in my heart. I have seen your form once, and I am now unable to forget it. My worldly affairs have ended because my attention is ceaselessly fixed on you. My inner vision is now opened, says Tuka, and you have revealed yourself to me within. Bhajan. By constant repetition of the Lord's name, a disciple experiences within himself the inner form of his Master and the inner sound and light. The act of listening to the sound is known as bhajan. Tukaram calls it kirtan. He says that it is this power of the Lord's name that leads to the union of the soul with the source, that is, the Lord. He counsels, in Kalyug, listen to the sound. You will be able to meet the Lord. Tukaram declares, when I become the Lord's slave in thought, word, and deed, I hear the sound of cymbals, taal, and drum, mridang. When one is entranced by inner music, all ill will is destroyed. This ecstasy cannot be experienced by Brahma and other gods. The inner light which was veiled shone forth in resplendence. The joy of seeing it cannot be compared to anything in the world. The unquenchable flame shines within me since the Lord has taken up residence. Dying while living. As already observed, it is through the practice of the name that the consciousness pervading every particle of the body is withdrawn to the eye center. This withdrawal enables a devotee to have spiritual experiences. Like Kabir, Dadu, Paltu, Namdev and other saints, Tukaram describes the process of vacating the body and reaching the eye center as dying while living. He says, "I have died to live." Saints say dying while living because on completion of this process, the devotee has no feeling in any part of the body, yet the soul does not leave the body permanently, but returns to it after the meditation period is over. It is only by thus vacating the body that the soul can journey homeward with the help of the sound and light. Tukaram says, "Once my body was vacated, the Lord was enthroned within me. The care of my entire being rests fully with Him. Because of the death of my ego, the Lord has taken up residence in me, and the unquenchable flame shines there." The mind. If God is not far away, but resides within the human body, why is it so difficult to realize Him? The most powerful obstacles on the spiritual path are mind and maya. In particular, to make spiritual progress, we all have to struggle with negative emotions. Lust, anger, greed, attachment, envy, and ego. Reference has been made earlier to these forces, but they are discussed here again, mainly with a view to focusing on the techniques taught to overcome them. The mind is a strong force. As S.G. Tulpule says, "The first obstacle on the path of anyone who tries silent contemplation is the upspringing of varying mental impulses which invalidate the one-pointedness of yogic endeavor." The mind is deeply attached to the objects and pleasures of the world. It runs after the illusory attractions of the world. It is fickle by nature and runs after worldly happiness. In the words of Tukaram, "Worldly happiness is like a mirage. It is never true." The mind never recognizes the transitory nature of worldly happiness, and so it keeps chasing worldly pleasure. It always wants one thing or another, so it never finds any lasting peace. Actions performed under the sway of the mind strengthen the seeker's attachment to the world. In accordance with karmic law, we take birth again and again in various species in this world, depending on the nature of our actions, both good and bad. Tukaram says that even our thoughts produce karmas. Merits and demerits do not depend only on outer actions, but also on the thinking of the mind. What is the solution? How can we point our mind in the right direction? The mind is a very bad master, but a very good servant. The solution lies in slowly making it our servant, by befriending it and giving it something better, higher, nobler, and more interesting to pursue than worldly pleasures. In other words, we must provide the mind with something so attractive that it will lose interest in everything else. Tukaram, like other saints, says that when it finds Naam or Shabad or divine nectar, the mind will be satisfied once and for all. This is the only effective antidote for the waywardness, cravings, and ills of the mind. The shackles of our karmas can be removed only by immersing our mind in Naam. Tukaram says, "Fix the mind on God. Do not allow it to wander. Avoid all laziness and sleep and embrace the Lord. keep your mind in one place and get merged in the Lord's feet. By practicing Naam persistently as taught by the Master, the devotee can get the mind to cooperate, transcend the karmic law, and attain God-realization. Negative emotions. The mind's basic problem is that it mistakes the illusory for the real. In addition to this general problem, the mind presents us with a number of particular obstacles to overcome, which have already been referred to as negative emotions: lust, anger, greed, attachment, envy, and ego. The seeker must wage a constant battle against them to reach God. Tukaram says, "Control the senses and forgive others. Then only will you get the Lord. No crop can be obtained without working hard for it, so you have to go through trouble to control the mind and obtain God-realization." In order to prevent the mind from having lustful fantasies, he advises us not to talk to a woman when alone. He prays, "O God, do not give me the company of other women. Because of them, I do not remember God nor do my bhajan." This mind cannot be controlled. Beauty leads to misery. According to Tukaram and all saints, the way to remove worry and misery is to have fewer wants and be unaffected by the ups and downs of life. He says, "After all, how much does a person require? Every day he needs a kilo of food and 6 feet of space to sleep on. All the rest is unnecessary. So why forget the Lord by getting attracted to other things and thirsting for them? One should live in this world uncontaminated by it, as a lotus leaf lives in water, uncontaminated by its drops. Praise and censure must fall off his ears as if he were absorbed within in a state of ecstasy. One should see the world, and yet it is to be taken as a dream. We can only do this when we rid ourselves of the egotism which is at the root of all these emotions." Tukaram says, "One who has purged himself of ego is like a wish-granting gem. His mind is as clear as crystal." The negative emotions attack the seeker and lure him away from the spiritual path. Tukaram advises us to attack these foes with the weapon of the Lord's name. By doing so, we can replace lust with continence, anger with tolerance and forgiveness, greed and envy with contentment, attachment with discrimination and detachment, and ego with humility. We should surrender to God's will and use the weapon of repetition. This weapon costs nothing. It is God's gift. Tukaram says, "Due to the Lord's name, I have become fortunate. My lust, anger, and greed have melted, and everywhere there is happiness. I have discarded for good all thoughts of family name, good breeding, and my appearance. I have offered my body to the Lord, to whom it really belongs. Now the ego has automatically been reduced to ashes, and by the grace of my Satguru, the light has been lit within." Worry, laziness, sleep, and overeating. The other obstacles that Tukaram refers to are worry, laziness, sleep, and overeating. As regards worry, he says, "In life, there is sometimes happiness, sometimes misery. Do not think of them too much. Don't let them affect you." He counsels, "Face whatever comes in life and don't blame the Lord. Then he will take care of you." We should give up all our worries and put our entire trust in the Lord. Tukaram says, "In the bosom of the stone there is a frog. Who feeds this frog but God? The birds and serpents do not lay aside anything. Who finds food for them but God? When you put all your burden on God, He, the ocean of compassion, will not neglect you. Tukaram deprecates laziness, overeating, and sleep as they are not conducive to spiritual progress.
He says,
with laziness and sleep, nothing can be achieved. Laziness is a big enemy. It even destroys our worldly life. How then can it lead to God realization? One has to conquer it. One way is to eat less. He exhorts, do not sleep much. Eat less. Thus one gets the Lord's grace and attains God realization. Our food should be simple. A heavy meal makes one lazy and lethargic. Tukaram asks, what shall I do with more sweets? They will only take care of the body, which in any case is filled with disease. Even dry bread will be as good as milk, sugar, and butter if it helps me to repeat the name of the Lord. Ethical conduct. Like other saints, Tukaram declares that the practice of Naam Bhakti and devotion to the Lord go hand in hand with ethical and moral conduct, self-discipline, and purification. He advocates speaking the truth, living within one's means, abstaining from criticizing others, correct social and sexual behavior, eating a vegetarian diet, abstaining from alcoholic drinks, and not killing God's creatures. These are essential prerequisites for God realization. Tukaram asks, if you do not desire others' money, if you do not slander others, and if you always treat other women as if they were your mother or sister, what do you lose? Why not believe what saints say? What effort is needed to speak the truth? Do only these things, he advises, and no other effort is needed to attach yourself to God. Tukaram further talks about slanderers thus. We are obliged to these washermen for washing away our faults. By the soap of their words, they take away our dirt without charging us anything for it. They are coolies who work for nothing and take up our burden for us. They carry us to the other side of the ocean of life, while they themselves go to hell. He deprecates meat-eating and warns, the Lord is within every being. Don't they understand that He lives in animals too? When they can see these creatures screaming in agony, how can the hands of these heartless ones go towards their throats? Such vile ones will have to suffer, says Tuka. They will be hurled into the fires of hell. The sole purpose of observing all the purificatory disciplines is to free ourselves from any harmful impulses and keep us in such a state of mind that we are able to meditate with devotion. Seekers have to undergo all the rigors of a stern discipline. Tukaram says, God realization is not a joke. To get it, one must give up his life. This life is like a seed which must be destroyed so that corn can grow and be harvested. Satsang and the company of devotees. Tukaram extols the benefit of attending satsang, keeping the company of saints and their devotees. This helps to increase our faith in the Master and His teachings and nurtures our love and devotion for God. Tukaram stresses the importance of attending satsang when he says, the Lord is present at satsang. Satsang is compared to a stream of water in which a stone is lying. Even if the stone does not melt, it is at least sheltered from the heat. Satsang is also compared to a hedge built around a crop to protect it from wild animals, bad company, and our own weaknesses. The company of saints purifies the seeker and elevates him. Tukaram says, the fires of the three attributes can be extinguished only by the company of saints. Footnote: three attributes, the three gunas, harmony, action, and inertia. They are the basic qualities of primordial matter out of which all creation proceeds. End footnote. He further says that the saints come into this world only to liberate humankind, and that their words are like nectar for the spiritually thirsty. Association with such saints is described by him as more sacred than any holy place of pilgrimage. While he praises the company of saints, he advises seekers to eschew evil company. Summary of Tukaram's teachings. The sum and substance of Tukaram's teachings is that God is not a matter of speculation or assumption, but a subject of perception and realization. The aim of human life is to work to find God and to know Him. Only a true master can enable us to achieve this objective. A spiritual aspirant should, therefore, first find a true master, and after initiation by such a master, he should follow the advice of that master and fully imbibe his teachings. He should attend spiritual discourses and keep the company of sincere devotees of the Lord in order to live in an atmosphere conducive to spiritual practice. He should avoid the company of worldly people and live a pure and disciplined life so as to conquer the mind and master his own weaknesses. Then he will be able to gather his scattered attention at one point and meditate wholeheartedly. Meditation and devotion will lead him to God realization.